Those are programmes this evening here on BBC One Scotland. The details of these and BBC Two's alternatives are in Radio Times. And now the first of those programmes, Coastal Journey.
It was here at Glenfinnan, at the head of Loch Sheil, that the clans rallied in August 1745 and raised the Jacobite standard. Traveller, says the inscription on the monument, if you wish to celebrate the deeds of former days, pay homage here now. Prince Charlie's lone statue is a magnet for tourists. It presides, too, over the annual Glenfinnan Games, and on this August afternoon, it's a rallying point for a quartet who are about to celebrate some enviable deeds of their own. They've planned a 60-mile unconducted tour through some of the most varied and isolated country in the West Highlands. This is where they leave the beaten tourist track, the exhaust fumes, the coaches and the caravans. Down Loch Sheil, out through the river, into the open sea at Loch Moidart, along the north coast of Ardnamurchan, round the point and east into Loch Sunart. Canoeing is the most mobile way of getting about there is. With a 3-inch draft, you can paddle anywhere you want and weather most storms. You can take more in your canoe than you could on your back. On this Ardnamurchan adventure, there's Jock Young, who's been canoeing since he was 2 years old. He's represented Britain in the Junior Slalom Championships. And then there's Sue Edwards and Captain Liz Elliot, who's been the Army's sprint and long-distance champion and who's canoed a lot in the Outer Hebrides. Sue has taught outdoor pursuits at the Benmore Centre in Dunoon, and she's now teaching in Edinburgh. Both girls come from Lancashire. Rusty Baillie climbed the north face of the Eiger in 1963. He's canoed down the Grand Canyon, and he made the first canoe crossing of the Gulf of California. So that's our team, all experienced canoers, ready for the first leg of the journey, which will take them down the inland waters of Loch Sheil.
Take a few days, somehow, to just cruise down the lochs and pot around on the sea. Once you get into it, then it's really enjoyable, it's really relaxing, and you can unwind and just sort of soak up the scenery and the atmosphere of the place.
Quite good to get used to your canoe on a nice flat bit of water before you actually get out onto the sea. Canoe touring is a nice relaxing way of getting fit for the competitions you're going for.
Halfway down Loch Sheil is Glenalladale, where Prince Charlie spent a night before moving on for his rendezvous at Glenfinnan. Close by is the sepulchre of St. Finan the Leper, who came here from Ireland 1,300 years ago. Legend says that he brought a small Celtic bronze bell with him, and today it lies chained and sheltered in a little stone alcove. It's protected by a local belief that ill luck will befall anyone who removes it.
It's supposed to be about 1,400 years old.
It was stolen once by four Hanoverian soldiers who were chasing Prince Charlie, and they decided they'd want it for a souvenir. But unbeknown to them, a Highlander had watched them take the bell, and he trailed them for days and nights and waited his opportunity to waylay them and retrieve the bell and bring it back here. Probably the curse is more efficient than the chain at keeping it here right now.
Because you can land anywhere you want, and because, unlike a sailing dinghy, you're not dependent on the wind, many people prefer a canoe to any other form of boat.
Obviously, the amount of equipment you can carry is restricted, but you can be self-contained. And, you know, with a reasonable group, you can get to places that certainly no other craft would get to.
Loch Sheil is about 20 miles long. In waters like these, you can easily cover a mile in 15 minutes. But as the loch gives way to the river at a harracle, the flow of the water towards the sea offers an even easier ride.
Often if I'm racing and I think, oh, this is a nice river, and oh, that's an interesting tree, and you know, everybody else is charging, sort of intent on getting to the finish, and I'm enjoying myself too much.
Tricky bit will actually be the slower fall here.
Okay, you have to be careful because it'd be very easy to rack your boat round about that.
That's good though, just come down the middle of the chute.
No, and just keep paddling.
You have to keep going on the right of the chute.
I'm going to wear my crash hat.
Need that.
What grade do you think it is, Sue?
3. What do you reckon?
Possibly, huh?
Possibly. Rusty?
Very difficult one, perhaps.
Quick.
How do you think you're going to manage in that old tub of yours there, Jock?
No bother. But you don't be falling in.
Thank you.
The great thing about a rapid is that you have a few moments to position yourself, and then there comes a stage when you know that there's nothing left that you can do, because then it's all sort of in the lap of the gods. And that's really an enjoyable moment there, when you're just absolutely committed to the river. That was quite a hairy bit of water, in fact, right there. You don't have any real life or death problem. There aren't any killer rocks just hidden beneath the surface that are going to do you in. But on the other hand, you had to take the right line through that rapid, because if you didn't hit it right, you did stand a chance of smashing up on the rocks.
Castle Tuorum was set on fire in 1715 by Alan Moore of Moidart, who, on his way to join the old pretender, had a presentiment that he would never return. Today, instead of the stout wooden galleys of Clan Ranald, the fiberglass canoes. One of the bonuses of canoeing at sea is that you have no problems of finding an overnight anchorage. In this part of the world, there's an idyllic camping site round every headland. There are few roads in the hinterland, and you can only reach most of these beaches by sea, so you choose the one you like best and paddle ashore. The castle, which lies in Loch Moidart, is sheltered by a small wooded island, Ellen Schoner. The channel behind the island isn't all that easy to navigate.
How about going round Ellen Schoner?
That sounds a good idea, but do you think it might be dried out?
It looks as though it dries out on the map, on the chart.
Tides are where they are at the moment. It'll not dry out properly, though.
No, it'll be okay, in fact, because although it dries out at low water and springs, it's about neap tides at the moment. We've got about 4 feet, and low tide's about 1 o'clock. So we should be okay if we set off now, anyway.
What about the current? Will the current be with us?
We're against the tides, no matter what way you go around it, though, because it's an island, coming down one side and going back up the other.
Yeah, but if we work on low tide being 1 o'clock, so that if we aim to get about here...
1 o'clock?
Yeah, about low tide. It won't really have got much strength up. I don't think the tide's very strong here anyway.
Sounds pretty good.
What was the weather forecast?
Well, we will have a wind of about 6, 4, 6 coming from the northwest.
Northwest will be great, you know, because it'll start...
Surfing,
as long as it doesn't get any stronger than 6 and last bit longer. The weather looks better now anyway.
The weather was not of the best, and their first encounter with wildlife in any substantial form were these seals sporting themselves on the seaweed rocks.
A fantastic sensation the day we actually got out onto the sea, because that was the only day we had reasonable weather, and suddenly to find that the water that was soaking you was salty and there were islands around you, it was really good.
Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the world. The rain's new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dew fall of the first brand. Praise for the sweetness of the wet garden, harder, sprung in completeness, where his feet had.
Nature is always neutral. I don't think nature is dangerous itself. What is dangerous, of course, is making a mistake. And the mistakes you make in the sea are different to the mistakes you can make in the river. If you do go in and you're in the water a long time, then you get very cold. You might die of exposure, which is not quite as glorious a death as being smashed up in a rapid, but just as effective. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light, Eden's or play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new day.
The most unpredictable part of this voyage round Ardnamurchan is marked by the lighthouse on the point. It commands one of the most spectacular seascapes in Britain, looking out to the small isles of Rum, Egg, Muck and Canna.
Why don't we delay our departure around this point until the ebb tides flow really strongly and help us along a bit?
It's only about one knot, but it'll make quite a bit of difference.
The wind and the tide will be against each other. Well,
that means low tides about 3 o'clock tomorrow.
How long's it going to take us?
About 3 hours, actually.
Three, and then we can stop on the way and have a look round.
With the canoes, we can get in places that a big boat couldn't touch.
And a final check on tomorrow's forecast.
Our weather forecast is westerly 4 to 5, fairly strong winds. Pretty shallowish, like what it is to do. The visibility is good.
Any gale warnings?
No, there's no gale warnings, not for the moment.
That sounds all right, doesn't it?
In the evening, a kayak at Sonahan. Time to relax before what could turn out to be a day demanding both skill and stamina from our four light-hearted dancers. Navigating the point in a fragile canoe is hazardous enough, but once past it, they'll be committed to a tough 5-mile passage beneath unbroken cliffs, rising in places to over 400 feet.
Party of canoes, and you're much more independent than you would be, say, in a sailing dinghy, because you can rescue the boats relatively easily, as long as you've got seaworthy boats and people who know what they're doing.
In the sea, perhaps you're you're more aware of how important your boat is to you, and the fact that you and your boat have to stay as one unit and work together would have been really bad news to come out of your boat.
You're going to stay the right way up, but when you're sea canoeing, you have to keep the other members of the group in sight, and particularly when there is a swell, if somebody tips over and doesn't manage to roll up, you're just not going to see them. You're very low down and close to the water level. You're not going to see somebody if they're a couple of waves away, so you keep looking around to see that the rest of the group are fairly close by.
I don't feel safe in a dinghy or any other boat. I only feel safe in my canoe. Because I know if anything happens, it's my own fault. When you're out in the middle of the sea somewhere, it's a different situation altogether. You can't swim to the side very easily. But that's what you go there for, the excitement, I suppose. The big water around the point. It's always in the back of your mind that it's very difficult to get out. It's difficult to climb a cliff with your canoe on your back.
David Wilkie is that rarity in British sport, a world, European and Commonwealth champion. Last December, he was voted Sportsman of the Year by the Sports Writers Association. It is hardly known by the British public. His success was born in Britain, but nurtured by almost 4 years of living and training in the United States. Miami, Florida, where Wilkie has spent most of his recent life. The hotels and the swimming pools proclaim a holidaymaker's paradise. But the climate that pulls 9 million visitors a year to this tropical playground is ideal too for a potential Olympic swimming champion. In March, it's 85 degrees.
Of course, since Alan Weeks recorded that pre-Olympic profile, David Wilkie has won gold and silver medals at Montreal. Well, on Friday at 6:20, BBC One Scotland presents a special programme, David Wilkie Comes Home. Reminiscing with David Wilkie over his swimming career will be coaches Dave Haller and Frank Thomas, BBC swimming commentator Alan Weeks and May Cochrane, the president of Wilkie's Warrender Club. Archie McPherson introduces Scotland's 1976 gold and silver Olympic medalist in David Wilkie Comes Home on BBC One Scotland on Friday evening at 6:20.